topic of my talk is suicide bombing and what we can do about it. The presentation is rated R, so if there is anybody here who is not over 18, you can close your eyes now. Okay, so I was working on my PhD somewhere in 2007, and I wanted to create some application for Facebook or LinkedIn. But when I see the news back home, this is what I see on every day. Doesn't matter what I do, whatever new application I make for Facebook or social networks, how it's going to save Pakistan, how it's going to benefit Pakistan. And I start thinking what I can do as a computer scientist to stop this craziness of suicide bombing. My advisor used to say to me that, Zeeshan, get good education and move to a bad neighborhood. And I always wonder what kind of education I can get and then move back to Pakistan to improve it. How I can make this bad neighborhood a good neighborhood. So I started to work on the suicide bombing problem. To get started, we started to working on the shockwave tube. So we made this shockwave tube. And then we start for the proof of concept for the four tomatoes. So we rupture quite hundreds of these tomatoes. And then we move to rats. So after doing experiments on the rats, we realized, number one, that rats are not humans. So we cannot really extrapolate the injuries from rats directly to the humans. And the rats are imprisoned under the blast. While in the real life, humans are not imprisoned. They are walking, and there are all kinds of humans. They are male, female, children, elderly, pregnant. And there are all sort of things in the real life. There are trees, there are rickshawala, there are strangyawala. So we have to encounter all of these effects into our simulation. So as an alternative, we start looking for the commercial software used by the military. And those software use the military data. And then we later realize that we cannot use the military data either. Because in the battlefield, military are between the age of 20 and 45. They are physically really fit. They are wearing the protective gears. And they are mostly males. Again, in the real life, we have males and females. We do not wear protective gears. So we cannot exactly match this data with whatever going on in the real life. So accuracy overall we are getting from these data were not that good. And then we look for the doctor's research. And doctors have done a really good research. They exactly know how much PSI a person would need to get some kind of injury on lung or ears. So we found there are two sides of the research. Number one is the military domain. That can tell us how much PSI a person will get based on the distance from the bomber. Number two is with doctors, that what kind of damage he will get based on how much PSI he will get. And then we decided let's merge the two. So we start collecting all kinds of data, all kinds of crazy data from all over Pakistan. So sketches, videos, footage, eyewitnesses accounts, x-rays, ECGs, patient's medical record, postmortem reports. And then we combine and we put all of these data together on our web portal called pakistanbodycount.org. So other researchers can use this data as well. So this is some examples of data. This is a sketch of Pakistan Ordnance Factory blast in Wakent, police reports. This is the data collection. By the way, this is how we store medical data in 21st century. So data collection again, medical legal reports, postmortem reports, couple of x-rays where you can see these nails and bolts. I'm sorry to show you this, but again, this is the deadly science we are going to, we are reverse engineering. CT scans, a few more x-rays, few more x-rays, and then the actual shrapnels that doctors recovered from the patient's bodies. So we made this Usmani-Kirk model based on the injuries and the, how far you are standing. And we got some shocking insights. For example, this is what happened. This is the percentages of injuries in a non-suicidal attack. If it is a suicidal attack, this is kind of injuries. So you can clearly see that we have more injuries in human torso in the suicide bombing attack. And then we group it based on the who claimed that attack. So this is the picture for the injury attacks of Balochistan Liberation Army. And this is Lashkar-e-Jhangvi. So if you can only provide me the medical legal reports of the patients, I can probably tell you who did the attack. Because based on their mechanism and how they formed the bombs. So now I'm going to move the, towards the live demo. So here I'm showing you the live demo of the actual software. Software, yeah. Okay, so we have a beautiful canvas here. Let me sit down, okay. Then you can plot persons here, one person and several persons here. So let me draw the TED here. So we are setting something like this. Then you can click on a person, you can rotate the person, you can define if he's a male or female, what is the height, what is the age, what is the weight, and then let me pick up the bumper. So where you want the bumper to be? Okay, let's put in the center. Okay. And then let me define that Bombard is, for example, carrying, let's say 12, otherwise everybody will be dead, 12 kilograms of TNT. Let me show you a couple of options here. Okay, this guy is 8.7 meter away from the bomber. This green light showing here means that all of the shrapnels, this guy will protect him from the shrapnels. So mainly the guy in the white will be saved, the, in the pinkish one will be injured, and the red one will be dead. But again, it also depends on the person. So a 2 months old infant might die in the white area, and 6 year, feet tall muscular guy might survive in the red area. Again, you can introduce the gender in the crowd, as somebody was talking about the gender. So yeah, I have the equal opportunity for all of them. So hey, we have females here wearing these skirts. And then you can introduce the children, and then explosive. So, okay, few ladies here with these skirts, okay. Okay, then I made the mathematical models of every single explosive available in the world. So you can define your own bomb. So what you want to become, make, TNT, C4, RDX, Patton, you name it. Fragments. How many fragments you want to put in the bomb? 30, 3,000, 4,000? What kinds of fragment? Nails, ball rings, screws, or the mixture? What is the shape of the bomb? Is it a suicide bomb jacket, a briefcase, a cylinder, a car? And then environment. You want to run a 2D environment, Cartesian grid, or 3D like this, while I'm on the stage and you are on the ground. And the, what is the temperature of the city? What is the altitude? Injury models. So we implemented all of the injury models. So Catherine D is the injury model used by US Army, city born by Russians, and the ones by the Britishers. And then Institute of Chemical Engineers model. And then we have our own model of Usmani-Kirk model. Then let me do the blast here. Okay. Okay. So what is saying, if this blast happen, 27 people will be killed and 43 will be injured. So if you move the cursor here, it will tell you in the here in the bottom that how much PSI this person will get. So this person will get 197 PSI and he will get 4 fragments. You can even visualize it. So after the bombing, this guy sitting on the front might look like this guy. Okay, and the, okay, there are other options as well. Okay, I am not showing you, the, okay. So you can have the model for car. You can have the model for tree, you can have the model for Hesco block. So there are different models. You can even have the model of this TEDx auditorium or any building you want. So just an example. Okay. Okay, so you can have any building. So you can put a tree over tree, a person over person, a car over car, and you can do the blast. There is another advantage of this software. You can do the forensic analysis. So you are sitting in a hospital, you don't know nothing. The only thing you know that some blast happened somewhere in Lahore. What to expect? How many people will be died? How many will be injured? What kinds of injury? Lung rupture, eardrum rupture, and you know nothing. So you just plant it here for forensic analysis. For you said there is a blast, 3% got killed, 12 got injured. And this software could regenerate the whole scene for you. That this was one of the possible ways bomber was there, that kind of explosive he was using, that kind of shrapnels he has. There was the orientation of the people. So we can really use with the forensics analysis as well. Now let me go back to my presentation. So there are three main uses of the software, as I described earlier. Number one is the preemptive measures. For example, one of the things we found, if you put the crowd in row-wise formation, as we sit in the mosque, or in the classrooms, or as we sit sitting right now, instead of circular fashion, you will have one-third of the casualties. So you can even save 33% of lives just by putting the people in particular formation. Second is the triage patients. So you are a doctor, there is a high official speaker who is giving the speech. And you might suspect that something like this might happen. Then what to expect? How many people will die? How many will be injured? You can have the complete list. How many doctors you need? How many paramedical staff you need? How many blood supplies you need? What kind of medicines you need? Third is the forensics analysis. When you don't know nothing, you can still, the software can still predict who did the attack based on the previous attacks, and where was the bomber, what kind of explosive being used, etc. For me, okay, then what? So we got this software, then what? For me, the terrorism is an emergent phenomenon where 2 plus 2 equals to 5. So this is the formula of suicide bombing. So you have a few bucks and a volunteer and a brainwashing expert and a bomb technician and pick and drop service. And then boom, you got an attack. By knowing all of these individual segments, you cannot predict where the next bomb is going to get off. Okay, so far we've been witnessing the suicide bombing attacks for the last 8 years. And so far, do you know what is our approach to solve these? Is this. All is well. No, sorry, all is not well. Clearly, all is not well. So you put these barbed wires. These barbed wires cannot stop the explosion. When explosion happens, it will all break up. It will kill everybody in the surrounding area. Those HESCO blocks, those concrete crosses, the military crosses you see, steel crosses, those cannot stop the explosion. It will propel it off. It will hit the building. It will make the building collapse. That steel wall of 14 feet, yes, it can stop the shrapnels, but it can also amplify the blast wave by 20 times. It can generate the reflection waves. So what someone need to do is to just bring 1 kilogram of TNT, because you are already amplifying it for 20 times, and you are already providing the shrapnels. So all of the things we are doing is totally unscientific most of the time. Okay, what we should do? So we usually try to solve these issues individually. Again, collective genius is the answer. We have to sit together, police, civil services, FIA, ISI, researchers, media, and the academicians. They have to all sit together to find out the patterns, find out what's been going on, and then we can predict the solution. This is a nice quote by Helen Keller. There is a terrible thing to see but have no vision. So far, we have no vision to fight against terrorism. This is the problem we face in our generation, and I'm not going to forward it to my following generations. We got this in our generation, and we are going to solve it. I was talking to one government official. We have to trust our local capabilities. And he goes like this. He said, Zeeshan, you know what? My heart breaks for the people of my country. I want to do something really, really big for the people of Pakistan. And I invite you to join me as a volunteer to serve this cause of Allah. And I said, how you can ask for the volunteerism? It's something we opt for. It cannot be imposed. Otherwise, it's slavery, not volunteerism. And then he said, Zeeshan, if you want to make money, go back wherever you came from. Go back to America. We don't need you. Pakistan doesn't need you. She was created on the name of Allah, and Allah will take care of it. And I said, you know what? This is my country, and I'm not going to leave because you are too old. So you are going to retire in a few years, and then you are going to die in another few years. I will wait for that day. I said, and I will wait for that day to opt for the position and bring the change my country deserves. And in the meanwhile, I will create the generation who will resist. By the way, that was my last day of consulting. Okay, we have the largest database of suicide bombing attack in Pakistan. We witness suicide bombing attack in Pakistan every 6 days. We can even provide the consulting to US Army, to Iraq, to Afghanistan, and to Israel. The same 180 million people who can produce few suicide bombers can also produce few officials who can hunt them down. Okay, here is a warning for all of you. This is my favorite verse. Be'amal dil ho to jazbaat se kya hota hai? Ho zami banjar to barsaat se kya hota hai? Hey amal lazmi takmeel tamanna ke liye, wana rangeen khayalat se kya hota hai? So if we don't act, and we don't act now, all of these wonderful TED Talks becomes a colorful dream, and that's it. This is the takeaway for today. In the end, this is our country. It deserves to be better. We can make it better, and it will be better. Ameen. Thank you very much.